Hello, everyone. Welcome to ASMR Chemistry. And as many of you know who have been subscribing for the past year, I love getting requests. So if you have any topics in chemistry that you'd like me to cover, please let me know. So, basically anything that's in high school chemistry, AP chemistry, college, general chemistry. Also, if it's basic organic chemistry or biochemistry or any kind of advanced some other things I'm forgetting, but in any case, today I'm going to be talking about a specific request that I got for electrochemistry. So, getting my ink here, and my, for some reason, the ink doesn't seem sticking as well as usual. I think I got it. So, I wanted to start with a review. Okay. And, I mean, a review of electrochemistry, yes, and an overview of it. Okay. So, when we are talking about electrochemistry, as it sounds, we're talking about movement of electrons. So, in terms of energy, we're looking at conversion between in either direction. Sometimes known as chemical potential energy. Okay. So essentially, let's start out with if we look at this direction. Okay. So if we're looking at electrical energy, let's use E. Not chemical engineering, but we're essentially, we're heading on the law of conservation of energy, right? That energy cannot be created or destroyed, just like matter that gets converted. So here, we would be using electrical energy to cause a chemical reaction. So what that means is that we essentially use an electrical current to cause a non-spontaneous redox reaction. So redox, reduction, oxidation. So essentially, we're using the electrical energy as our input. Okay, we're driving this non-spontaneous reaction. So if you can hear those paw prints, or those little paw steps, electroplating. So that's using electricity to plate usually some kind of metal. So maybe you have something that's gold plated. Splitting reaction is essentially what plants do, photosynthesis. In that first step, they use photons of light to come in, and eventually it causes movement of electrons that occurs in various parts of photosystem too. And there's manganese atoms and their manganese ions, and the movement of electrons then causes water to become oxygen. That's why plants release oxygen, and then also the hydrogen ions, or if you're doing electrolysis of water, you get hydrogen. Main point here is that you're causing something that is non-spontaneous by electrical energy. Okay, so let's look at the opposite, and that is if we have chemical potential energy, that's that. Causing the movement of electrons, or in other words, electrical energy. So now, this is where we have a spontaneous redox reaction. There's a spontaneous redox reaction happening. You can then harness the flow of electrons. Okay, so we have to use a little bit of engineering here as well. Of electrons I mean by that is that we're controlling the flow of electrons from the between the oxidation reduction half reactions. Okay. And so this is how we can get that electrical energy out by harnessing, because it does happen. So we'll be going into more details of this, but the best example of this is batteries. Oops, batteries. So all batteries have spontaneous redox reactions, and then they're set up. Direction is recharging the batteries. This is when the batteries are giving us power, and then we can use, plug it in, and we can recharge the battery. Okay. So, as you can see, both of these, we have redox. Redox. Okay, so we must always couple together. This is always, okay, because you need to have a source of electrons, you need to have somewhere for them to go, so we're always going to have these paired together. And if you can't remember which is which, there's another, there's actually probably even more than these two, but here's another one, oil rig. Okay, and this is oxidation. So, we're always seeing that there's a flow of electrons from whatever the species is, loses electrons. That's going to be the source of electrons that then goes to whatever the species is that's gaining electrons. So they'll always be paired. So then the question is, how do we know, when we pair them together, which species will lose electrons and which one will gain? And that is where we need table handy. Oh boy. It's bad. I think I need a new one. Okay, so this is a standard. Reduction potentials. Okay. Question might be, what does this mean? I'm also, I'm going to give you the symbol. Okay. It's E for reduction potential. This means standard conditions, 25 degrees Celsius. Okay. And reduction, you often have a little red show that's a reduction potential. So, the table of standard reduction potentials tells you how easily something is reduced. So you could even think of it as the potential of something to be reduced, just like we were talking about, like your potential to learn chemistry is increased by watching ASMR chemistry videos. But anyway, so this table is used to compare. And I'm going to show you a table. I have some overheads. I can show you an example and kind of everything into half, and we just look at the addition of electron, or in other words, reduction, for a whole bunch of different common species. They could be ions, they could also be molecules as well. They could be also just an atom. There's different possible states. It could be aqueous or liquid. It could also be gas. And as you can see here, there's different number of possibilities of the number of electrons that can be added. Okay. So, this particular table, it starts, I don't like this one actually, because it starts with negative. I always like it when they have the positive ones first, because here it shows a large negative number, and it gets to be less negative as we go down here. So these numbers are increasing as we go down this table. Okay, so what does that mean? It's getting bigger, larger value as you go down. That means that iron plus 3, gaining 3 electrons to become iron metal, elemental iron, this will happen more easily than, say, nickel. Nickel plus 2, plus 2 electrons. Okay, so this reduction, because it's a larger number than this one, this will happen more easily. So a larger reduction potential means more easily reduced. So I'm gonna show you. I'm gonna take this one away. And So that means each of these listed here are getting reduced more and more easily as you go down this table. The largest value that we see here is for fluorine. Okay. Fluorine on the periodic table, very, very easily reduced. Okay. This is a very small atom. Right? So it'll easily gain electron. Okay. Here is its noble gas configuration. So it will be more easily reduced than, let's say, the chlorine gas. Reduction potential is smaller than this one. Same with bromine. Smaller value than chlorine. So here actually, chlorine, bromine. Here we're seeing the periodic trend. Fluorine is more easily reduced than chlorine and bromine. And that can be explained if we go into more about the structure of the atom. We're not talking about that in this video, but that is something you can think about. I'm sure I'll be talking about periodic trends for sure in another video. Okay. So, quantitatively, we need to use these values from the tables. I want to show you one other part of this table. This one here, there's one that's highlighted. Okay. What do you notice about this one? Zero. The reduction of hydrogen ions to make hydrogen gas. It was selected to be zero, and everything else is compared to this. So the way that these values were measured was essentially by what is its difference from hydrogen, the reduction of hydrogen ions. They could have chosen something else and everything would have been compared to that, but the electrochemists in the day decided to make it all relative to hydrogen. They had to make it relative to something, so may as well be hydrogen. It's very common, especially in aqueous solution. If you think about the pH changing, that would be very using values here when we're trying to understand what is going to be our reduction half reaction and what would be the oxidation half reaction. Okay. So let us, because I do want to talk about how batteries work, but I also think it's good to use our intuition a little bit and predict what would happen. Okay, let's make a prediction. Okay, so let's use... Oh no. I think my pen is finally just not happy. So this is a standard reduction potentials. Let's look at it qualitatively. And what I mean by that is to predict if we have two different species, to try to predict which one more easily reduced than the other one. Okay. So let's look at copper and zinc. Okay. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna imagine that we have two separate containers, and we're gonna put two solutions. Okay, so these are like beakers or something, test tube, and then here metal to each one. Okay. So here's the question. All right, in this one, you've got copper plus two. This is solution. This gorgeous blue. Little side note there. Okay. Here we've got zinc solution. It's also plus two. Aqueous. This would be colorless solution. Another side note. Okay. Now what we're gonna do is this piece of metal here is a piece of zinc. Try to predict what would happen. Will the copper plus two react with the zinc metal? Will the zinc plus two aqueous react with the copper metal? Okay, we're going to try to make a prediction. So we would use our table and we would look up the reduction. I'm gonna write it out here. Okay, so look at the table, we would see the reduction of copper to become oxidation number 0. This has a reduction potential of minus So we think about what this means. Okay. So we just talked about if the reduction potential is larger, that means copper plus two more easily reduced. Zinc plus two. Okay, so that means that this direction, this reduction half reaction, this is what will happen. Whereas, because zinc is harder to reduce, that means it's more easily oxidized. And so, the zinc will actually, the reverse will happen when it's coupled with copper. So, they're together. See, when you use the table, we want to make direct comparisons. We want to compare apples to apples. And so, that's why they're all listed as figure out which one's more easily reduced. But then, once we figure it out, that's when we can flip the other half reaction and pair them together. Okay? So, we take these, and now we look at as a redox reaction, where they're paired. Now, the copper, having the larger reduction potential, that one's going to stay the same. Okay, so we'll write it as is. Okay. But whichever has the smaller reduction potential, be reversed. So remember, reduction, oxidation, they always happen pairs together. So zinc gets oxidized, and there's our two electrons. Now it just so happens this one gains two. This one loses two. So we didn't have to multiply through by any coefficients. But you do always want to have the number of electrons that are gained in the reduction half reaction must be equal to the number of electrons lost in the oxidation half reaction. Electrons cancel out. Okay. So that means this reaction, copper plus two, zinc metal, creating copper metal, zinc, this redox reaction. Identified that copper is more easily reduced based on reduction potential. So because we identified this, and then therefore we coupled them in this way, that means that this redox reaction will happen spontaneously. So now we look and we say, okay, these will react spontaneously, and there will be a transfer of electrons. So let's look back up here and see. Copper plus 2 will react with zinc metal to form copper solid plus zinc plus 2. So this beaker with copper plus 2 solution with zinc in it, we will see a chemical redox reaction happen. This one, however, here the copper is already reduced. Copper is more easily reduced than zinc. So you can think of this as essentially it's done. It's already done. Copper is already all reduced. The zinc is all oxidized. So this one will stay unchanged. Whereas this one, we will see a change. Okay? The change we would see was that we would see a buildup of copper-colored, well, copper metal would build up on the surface, the zinc here, and this blue copper solution would get lighter and lighter, since the copper ions are then building up as copper metal, as copper metal on the surface of this, so we'd start to lose those ions in solution. So we'd see a change here, but we'd not see a change here. That whole prediction is just based on the fact that we know the reduction potentials. So you do need to have table reduction potentials. It's handy. Okay, I think this is actually a good stopping point. There's a lot more that we can do with talking about cell potentials, reduction potentials, and creating a battery. And so I think I'm going to do a separate video talking about that. There's so much to talk about with electrochemistry. Oh my gosh, it's just, there's a lot. It's really amazing. And so many applications to biochemistry. Sorts of things that we will be covering, and I'm going to try to get on more of a schedule. So I'm going to try to release videos on Wednesdays and Fridays for you. So that's my plan right now, and I'll let you know if that changes. Okay. All right. Thank you so much. I'll see you next time.